Do you recall the situation on which the curtain has fallen thousands of times in thousands of well-regulated dramas? Do you remember how they faced each other and how there were tears in his eyes or her eyes or their eyes? Do you mentally picture how he or she or they brushed the above-mentioned tears away or let them remain where they were? And how she whispered, "Yes, Jack," or "Yes, William," or "Yes, Eliphalet," as the case might have been, or sometimes only plain yes. And how he, with the expertness gained by many rehearsals, gathered her into his arms and printed a kiss on her brow, or her cheek, or her hair, or behind her ear, but only in the rarest of instances on her lips. And how the happy pair, now forever united until the next performance, stood looking out over the footlights, estimating the box office receipts and the amount of paper in the house until the curtain fell and the thoughts of the audience turned to the inner man. And then, what happens next? There are inquisitive souls who ask that question. Will they live happily ever afterward? Or will the matrimonial bark encounter one of the many obstacles which somehow have been forgotten? The dramatist looking upon marriage or its forerunner engagement as the end of all things neglects to tell us, starting with a variable number of eligible young persons of opposite sex. He has paired them off in such combinations as his experience tells him will be pleasing to the magnet who produces the play, to the temperamental ladies and gentlemen who act in it, and last and most important, to that source from which all royalties flow, that unaccountable, irresponsible, consciousless creature, the audience. To the very portals of marriage he travels with his charges, but there he leaves them to act as guide, philosopher, friend to others following in their footsteps. But of the time between, of the time immediately after she has said yes and before she has begun to say no.
Give him back to me. his life. Did he tell you he did?
No. I found out at the florist. He orders flowers twice a week and has them sent to your dressing room.
That's a
charged
lie.
To him.
That's a lie.
It isn't. Do you mean to say that I am lying?
I mean to say someone is lying to you.
And what about this letter?
Letter?
Yes. I found it and he wrote it.
He wrote it?
Yes, I...
Let me see.
No! I'll read it to you myself. My darling, shan't be able to come to the theater tonight. Urgent business. 1,000 apologies. 10,000 kisses. Alfred!
Oh.
He probably meant to send it to you here at the theater by messenger, but he forgot. And I opened it!
You mustn't cry.
Why mustn't I cry? You steal my husband and I mustn't cry? Why, I know how easy it is for you. One night, you dress up like a royal princess. And the next night, you undress like a Greek goddess. You blacken your eyebrows and redden your lips and paint your lashes. You have an artist's words to make you seem witty and wise. It's no wonder a poor, simple-minded lawyer falls in love with you! What chance do I have against someone like you in my own plain dress, my own lips and brows, my own unstudied ways? I don't know how to strut and pose and lure a man. I don't have Mr. Shakespeare to write beautiful lines for me. In reality, you may be more stupid than I am. But I'll admit, when it comes to alluring men, I'm no match for you!
This is a very interesting case.
What is?
Yours.
Mine?
I mean, I've never received a flower or a letter or anything else from your husband, for that matter. Tell me. Have you and your husband been getting along rather badly as of late?
Well, I mean, yes, of course. I mean...
And you used to be affectionate to one another.
Why, yes.
And lately you've been cold?
Yes!
Of course, it's a typical case.
What is mine?
My dear, if you knew how many times us actresses meet this sort of thing. It's one of the oldest things. I think your husband is playing a little comedy to make you jealous to revive your interest back in him.
Do you really think so? I mean, do you mean this sort of thing has happened to you before?
Endless times. It's one of the oldest expedients in the world. And us actresses are such conspicuous targets for it. There's not a man who is associated with the theater who hasn't used us in that way at one time or another. There's authors, composers, scene designers, set directors, lawyers, orchestra leaders, and even the managers themselves. To regain the affection of a wife or a sweetheart, all they have to do is invent a love affair with one of us. And the wife is always so ready to believe it, and half the time we don't know a thing about it. But when it's brought to our notice, we don't seem to mind so much. At least we have the consolation of knowing we are the means to many a happy marriage, which might have otherwise ended in the divorce court.
But how was I to know?
Oh, no need to apologize. You couldn't know it, of course. It's all so plausible. You fancy your husband in an atmosphere full of perpetual temptation, a backstage world full of beautiful sirens without scruples or morals, and you think one actress is more dangerous than 100 ordinary women. And no one knows that better than your husband, who evidently is a very cunning lawyer. He plays on your fears and jealousies to regain the love you deny him. He writes a letter and leaves it behind him on the desk for you to find,
Trust a lawyer never to do that unintentionally. He probably orders flowers for me by telephone in the morning, and the minute he gets to his office, he cancels the order. Say, he wouldn't happen to have a lock of my hair, would he?
Yes, in his desk drawer. I brought it with me.
My hairdresser! They bribed my hairdresser to steal from me. It's a wonder I have any hair left at all.
Is that how he got it?
I can't imagine how else. Do you know what? I would have written him a letter if he would have come to me frankly and said, I say, Sarah, my wife and I aren't getting along as of late. I'm wondering, could you write a love letter that I could leave lying around the house or my wife might find it? Oh, I wrote 10 like that for a very prominent playwright once. He had no luck with them. His wife was such a proper young person that all she did was return them to him, all unread.
How clever you are. How good. How good.
I am neither nor better nor worse than any other actress in the theater, even though you do consider us such monsters.
I've been a perfect fool.
Well, you do look a bit silly sitting there with tears in your eyes and your face flushed with happiness, because you know a young blonde man with spectacles loves you after all. My dear, no man deserves to be adored as much as that.
Well, I guess that's my own problem then.
Now, let me give you a bit of parting advice. Don't let him fool you like this again.
He won't. Never fear.
No matter what you may find in his pockets, handkerchiefs, letters, photos of me, appointments he makes, letters he sends, don't be taken in a second time.
Oh, you can be sure of that. And you won't tell him of my coming here, will you?
Oh, not a word. Frankly, I'm upset he didn't come over to ask permission to use my name the way he did.
You are a perfect dear, and I just don't know how to thank you.
Now don't start crying again.
Oh, but you've made me so happy. Thank you.
All right, Alfred. Alfred, you can come in now. She's gone.
I think I'll have... Oh, what gorgeous! other tables have any. Fred, did you?
Yes, I did. I knew you would like them.
Oh, I do. But you mustn't be a silly boy any longer, Fred.
I will, too. It's not silly to give you flowers.
Well, of course not. Goodness knows I love the flowers. But I'm not a young idiot who expects a honeymoon to go on forever. I have had one experience, you know.
Yes, but you can't judge all men by him.
I don't. It's just that... Well, I just don't know.
I am going to show you that a real man don't get over the fun of being married to a peach like you in 2 weeks. You don't want me to, do you?
Of course not. You were certainly different. That's why I married you. It's just that I don't expect you to set a pace that you can't keep up. You'd hate me in no time if I did.
I could never hate you, dearie. Besides, isn't this our first night back in the old town? Why, we shan't be eating out like this every day.
Well, it's just, I don't want you to flop all of a sudden like he did. What do you have, a cocktail?
Let's see. What is it?
It's him.
Him who?
George.
George? Well, good Lord, don't worry about him. He's got nothing on you now. You're mine.
Of course I am. He's not looking. He's with a woman. By jingo, it's that millinery kid.
What millinery kid? Besides, what difference does it make? Let him have 100 if he wants. We're happy.
That nerve of him. I knew it was her right along. He tried to throw a bluff that it was some swell. I bet he paid good for those clothes.
So what? Come on. Besides, she probably made them herself.
Made them herself? Oh, don't you know about ladies' gowns? That's from the Avenue Straight.
So what if it is? I'll get you a better one. You just wait.
There. Now he's looking over here. Of
look at me and you won't see him. What's he done?
He's smiling as if nothing ever happened. That he's going to say something mean about me now.
Look, I'm hungry. Let's change seats.
Change nothing? Catch me giving him a laugh like that? I could do her a thing or two, the young. There, now she's looking too.
So what? Come on.
He's getting up.
What?
Of all the brass.
What's he doing?
He's coming over here.
He is. Don't say a word. I'll take him on.
If he dares.
Hello, Marion. What? Got a grouch on your honeymoon?
That's not
a good sign, Marion.
No, I don't have a grouch on. The only grouch I ever had was you.
Well, then, isn't every woman gets rid of an incompatible husband and gets hold of a compatible one all in same season?
Look here.
That's just like him. Coming over here with a grin on his face like a kid with a new toy. We don't want anything to do with you, see?
Sure. Excuse me for butting in. I just wanted to make a little announcement.
Married already? I didn't think you had to marry someone like that.
I knew you'd have your little knife out for her. But what you should have to be jealous about now, I can't see.
I'm not jealous.
What are you worrying about then?
I'm not worrying. I'm just sore because you bought it in when we were having such a fine time together without you.
Oh. Excuse me. As a matter of fact, I didn't come over to make an announcement. It's too late for that.
You couldn't wait a decent amount of time?
Well, I waited a day longer than you did, anyhow.
Oh, that's different.
Now look here. We were just walking.
Yes,
get...
What did you butt in for?
If you don't have an announcement to make...
I got a letter from your friend Grace.
Grace? What did she have to say to you?
She said that she was sorry I had to get a divorce. But I told her that...
Sorry that you had to get a divorce? Oh, if I don't fix her...
Oh, she's getting married, too.
Who to?
That fella, what's his name? That's got that garage over on 7th Avenue.
Oh, Snyder! So he's the one... She's going to be all over town now in a new car.
Sure. Oh, saw him today. Big yellow one. I always told you she was out for money, but you thought she was in love with Jackson.
Hypocrite! She was! She said she was. She cried all over me. Have you seen Jackson?
Yes. And he's as blue as... your old kimono.
Now look here! I am not going to wait all night for my dinner!
Well, hurry, old dinner! What did Jackson have to say?
Well, you know, he's still in love with Grace, and he thinks he can win her back.
Waiter! Waiter, I'm hungry! Come on!
Observations about me.
Well, this is twice in 3 weeks that you've been here 5 minutes late in the morning.
Is that all? You don't think my stuff's falling off, do you?
Oh no, Mrs. Prout. I know it's not falling off. I was just gonna tell you, the butler's been in, and he wished me to inform you that he begs to give notice. It seems that last night you ordered him to cut the leaves of our new novel. He said that he's looked into it, and he thinks it's disgraceful to ask a respectable butler to cut the leaves of such a book. So he begs to give warning. Oh no, Mrs. Prout, your stuff's not falling off.
What did you say to that?
First I looked at him, and then I said, Brown, you will probably be able to take up a place on the reviewing staff of the Methodist Recorder.
Christine, I truly believe you'll come to employ a secretary of your very own someday.
I hope so, Mrs. Prout, but I intend to keep off the morbid introspection line. You do that so awfully well. I think I shall go in for a smart dialogue. Marquises, country homes, and a touch of old-fashioned human nature at the bottom. Seems to me that's what's coming along very shortly. Shall we begin, Mrs. Prout?
I suppose so. Anything interesting in the press cuttings?
Nothing very special. The Morning Call, genius in every line. The Daily Reporter. Poor Prout may be talented, we should hesitate to deny it, but she is one of several of our leading novelists who should send themselves to a board school in order to learn grammar.
Grammar again! I swear they must keep a grammar in the office. Personally, I think it's frightfully bad manners to speak of grammar to a lady, but they never had any class at the Reporter. Let that be the end of the discussion.
Right, which will you begin, Mrs. Prout? There's the short story in the Illustrated monthly, 6,000 words, promised for next Saturday. There's the article on women's diversions in the Illustrated, I'm sorry, in the British Review. They wrote for that yesterday. There's also the short series that begins in the Sunday's Daily Sentinel in September. You've only done half the first installment of that. And of course, there's Heartache.
I think we'll start with Heartache. I feel it coming on. We'll do the short story for the Illustrated tomorrow. Where had I got to?
Let's see. The inanimate form of the patient lay like marble on the marble slab of the operating table. The sponge, nurse, said the doctor. Where is it? That's where you got to.
Yes, yes, I remember. Isabel smiled imperturbably at the doctor. New line, quote marks. I fear, doctor, she said, in a moment of forgetfulness, we have sewn it up in our poor patient. New line, quote marks. Damn, said the doctor, so I have. Rather good, that. Eh, Christine?
Oh, Mrs. Prout, I think it's beautiful, so staccato and crisp. By the way, I forgot to tell you that there is a leader in the Daily Snail against your medical accuracy in the forum. You remember the article, Medicine and Fiction? The Snail backs up the forum for what it's worth in. Mrs. Pratt, you are ill. I was sure of it. What can I get for you?
Nonsense, Christine. I'm fine. A little unstrung is all. I want for nothing.
Your imagination is too much for you.
Perhaps so.
But it isn't all due to an abnormal imagination. You haven't been quite cheerful since you turned Mr. Adrian out.
Christine, you forget yourself.
I forget nothing, Mrs. Prout. Myself least of all. Mr. Adrian is your dead husband's son, and you've turned him out of this house, and now you feel sorry for it.
Christine, you know perfectly well that I requested him to go, because he would insist on making love to you, which interfered with our work. Besides, it's not quite nice to make love to the secretary of one's stepmother. I should wonder you're indecent enough to bring it up. You should never have permitted his advances.
I didn't permit them. I wasn't asked to. I tolerated them. I've never been secretary to a lady novelist with a stepson before, and I wasn't quite sure what was included in my duties. I always like to give satisfaction.
You do give satisfaction. Let that be the end of the discussion.
Damn, said the doctor, so I have. Damn, said the doctor, so I have.
Christine, did you happen to find anything out about the author of that article, Medicine and Fiction?
Is that what's bothering you, Mrs. Prout? Of course it was an awful attack, but it's not like you to trouble about critics.
Oh, it's bothered me more than I can possibly say. That's why I asked you to make a few discreet inquiries.
I did ask at my club.
What did they say there?
They all laughed at me and said everybody knew that you had written it yourself in order to keep the silly season alive. July being a sickly month for reputation.
What did you say to that?
I should prefer not to repeat it.
Christine, I insist. Honestly, your modesty is becoming a disease.
I said they were fools.
Oh, a little abrupt perhaps, but effective.
Not to see that the grammar was better, different than ours.
Is that what you said?
It was, and I settled them.
Christine, I believe I know who the author of that article was.
Who?
Dr. Gardner.
But he lives on the floor below in the very flat underneath this.
I know. It is just too awful.
But he's here nearly every night.
Who told you that?
No, Mrs. Prout, please be calm. The butler told me. I didn't ask him, and as I cannot be expected to foretell what my employer's butler will say before he opens his mouth, I am not to be blamed. Shall we continue?
Do you really think Dr. Gardner wrote the article? I would give worlds to know.
Do you mean that you would give worlds to know that it was Dr. Gardner or that it wasn't Dr. Gardner? Or would you give worlds to know who the author is, no matter who it might be?
You are terribly unsympathetic this morning. Mm.
I am placid, nothing else. Please recollect that when you engaged me, you asked if you might rely on me to be placid as your previous secretary when you dictated the pathetic chapters to her, whipped so freely into her notebooks that she could hardly keep her stuff down, besides permanently damaging her eyesight. Since you ask my opinion as to Dr. Gardner being the author of this attack on you, I say that he is not. Apart from the facts that he lives on the floor below and that he is, as the butler says, a constant visitor in the evenings, there is the additional fact, a fact that I have observed on several occasions for myself without the assistance of the butler, that he likes you.
You've noticed that. It's true. But does he like me enough not to attack my name in the public press? That is the point. The author of that horrid article says that he holds no personal animus and that his actions are articulated solely from the cause of medicine and the medical profession.
Do you mean to infer that the author of this article might, as a man like you, will as a doctor, he despised you?
That is my suspicion.
But Dr. Gardner does more than like you. He adores you.
He adores my fame, my talent, my wealth, my genius. But does he adore me? I'm no ordinary woman, and it's no use pretending that I am. I must think of these things.
Neither is Dr. Gardner an ordinary doctor. His research is in toxicology.
Oh, his research mean nothing to me. I wish he weren't a doctor at all.
But even doctors have their place in this world.
They should mind their own business rather than poking their noses into fiction where it doesn't belong.
But if fiction meddles with them, you know that fiction is very meddlesome. It pokes its nose with great industry.
Christine, you have never understood me. Let that be the end of the discussion.
Damn, said the doctor, so I have.
A smile flashed across the lips of Isabel as she took up the glittering knife. Oh, Christine, I am so sure Dr. Gardner wrote it.
Very well, madame, he wrote it. We've at last settled something.
Oh, you poor dear, you were absolutely hysterical this morning. You must go and lie down for a little. A horizontal posture is what you need.
Perhaps you're right. I'll leave you for an hour. Christine, would you take down a note for Dr. Gardner? He might come by this morning. He rather will, I think. Tell him the answer to his question is no, with a capital N.
Shall I sign it?
Yes. Sign it CP. And if he comes, give it to him yourself. And say that I will see no one. Oh, and Christine, would you mind seeing to the butler and see if you can get him to take a more sensible approach to my novels? In my current state of health, I could hardly stand the change. And he is so admirable at the table.
Shall I offer him some compromise in our next novel?
Anything, anything if he'll stay.
Try to get some rest. Isabel took up the glittering knife, did she? The answer to the question is no, with a capital N. CP sounds like Carter Peterson. Now, as I have nothing to do, I think I will devote the morning to an article on hysteria in lady novelists. The answer to the question is no, capital N. What question? That the lily-white hand of the author of Heartache has finally... Come in.
Oh, good morning, Miss Stevenson.
Good morning, Dr. Gardner. You seem surprised to see me here, yet I am to be found in this chair daily at this hour.
Not at all, not at all. I assure you, I fully expected to find both you and the chair. I also expected to find Mrs. Prout.
Are you capable of interrupting our literary labors? We never see callers this early, which reminds me that I've several times remarked that this office ought not to have a door leading into the hallway.
As to that, might I venture to offer the excuse that I had an appointment with Mrs. Prout?
At what hour? She never sees anybody before noon.
I believe she did say 12 o'clock.
And it is 25 minutes to 10. Punctuality is a virtue. You may be said to have raised it to the dignity of a fine art.
I will wait. I trust I do not interrupt.
Yes, Doctor, I regret to say that you do. I was about to commence the composition of an article.
Upon what?
Upon hysteria and lady novelists.
Surely lady novelists are not hysterical.
The increase of hysteria in that class of persons is one of the saddest features of the age.
Oh, dear me. But I can tell you the name of one lady novelist who isn't hysterical, and that perhaps the greatest name of all, Mrs. Prout.
Of course not, Doctor. Nevertheless, Mrs. Prout is somewhat indisposed this morning.
Cora? Ill? What is it? Nothing serious?
Rest assured, the merest slight indisposition, just sufficient enough to delay us an hour or two in our work. Nerves, you know. The imagination of a great artist, Dr. Gardner, is often too active, too stressful for the frail physical organism.
Ah, you consider Mrs. Prout a great artist?
Dr. Gardner, even to ask such a question. Do not you?
I? To me, she is unique. I say, Miss Feversham, were you ever in love?
In love? I've had preferences.
Among men?
No, among boys. Recollect that I am only 20, though singularly precocious in shrewdness and calm judgment.
20? You amaze me, Miss Feversham. I have often been struck by your common sense and knowledge of the world. They would do credit to a woman of 50.
I'm glad that you do not stoop to offer me vulgar compliments about my face.
I am incapable of such conduct. I esteem your mental qualities too highly. So you have had your preferences among boys?
Yes, I like to catch them between 18 and 20. They are so sweet and fresh then. Like new milk, the employee of the Express Dairy Company who leaves me my half pint at my lodgings every morning is a perfectly lovely dear.
Is he one of your preferences then?
A preference among milkmen, of whom, as I change my lodgings so frequently, I have known many. Then there is my postman. Oh, not a day over 18, I am sure of it, though that is contrary to the regulations of St. Martin's Grand. You should see my postman, Dr. Gardner. When he brings them, I can accept even rejected articles with equanimity.
I should be charmed to see him. But tell me, Miss Feversham, have you had no serious preferences?
You seem awfully interested in this question of preferences.
I am.
Doctor, I will open my heart to you. It is conceivable that you may be of some use to me. You are on friendly terms with Adrian, and doubtless you know the history of his exit from this house. Doctor, Adrian and I are passionately attached to each other. Our ages are precisely alike. It is a beautiful ideal. Or rather, it would be if dear Mrs. Prout didn't try to transform it into a tragedy. Not only has she turned the darling boy out, but she has absolutely forbidden him the house.
Well, doubtless she had her reasons.
I'm sure she had. Only, you see, her reasons aren't ours. We could easily get married at once if we chose. I could keep Adrian so easily. I do not, however, wish to inconvenience dear Mrs. Prout. It is a mistake to quarrel with the rich relations of one's future husband. I was thinking that perhaps you, Dr. Gardner, might be able to persuade Mrs. Prout that my marriage to Adrian need not necessarily interfere with the duties as her secretary.
Anything I can do, Miss Feversham, you may rely on me doing.
You're a dear.
But why should you imagine that I have any influence with Mrs. Prout?
I do not imagine. I know. It is my unerring insight over again, my faultless observation. You did not begin to question me about love because you were interested in my love affairs, but because you were interested in yours and could not keep off the subject. I read you like a bug. You love Mrs. Prout, my dear doctor. Therefore, you have influence over her. No woman is uninfluenced by the man that loves her.
You have noticed that I admire Mrs. Prout. It appears nothing escapes you.
That is a trifle. The butler noticed it.
The butler?
The butler.
Let it. Let the whole world notice.
Miss Feversham, be it known that I love Mrs. Prout with passionate adoration. Before the day is out, I shall either be her affianced bridegroom or I shall be a dead man.
You proposed to her last night.
I did.
And you were to come for the answer this morning.
Yes. Oh, can you guess it, I'm eager? Excited? Oh, can you not pardon me for thinking it is noon at 25 minutes to 10? Oh, Miss Feversham, if Adrian adores you with 1/10 the fire with which
Stop,
I adore
Doctor. This. I do not wish to be a burnt sacrifice. Now, let me ask you a question. You have seen that article against Mrs. Prout, entitled Medicine and Fiction in this month's issue of the Forum. Do you know the author of it?
I don't. Has it disturbed Mrs. Prout?
It has. Did she not mention it to you?
Not a word. If I did know the author of it, if I ever do know the author of it, I will tear him limb from limb.
I trust that you will chloroform him first. It will be horrid of you if you don't.
I absolutely decline to chloroform him first.
You must.
I won't.
Never mind. Perhaps you will be dead. Remember that you have promised to kill yourself today on a certain contingency. Should you really do it? Should you put an end to your life if Mrs. Prout gave you a refusal?
I swear it. Existence would be meaningless to me.
By the way, Mrs. Prout said that if you called, I was to say that she could see no one.
See no one? But she promised it.
However, she left a note.
Oh, give it me instantly. Why didn't you give it me before?
I had no opportunity. Besides, I haven't transcribed it yet. It was dictated.
Dictated? Are you sure?
Yes, she dictates everything.
Well, read it to me. Read it to me. Quick, I say.
Here it is. Are you listening?
Great heavens! Well?
The answer to his question is...
Well, go on!
Yes, CP, there, I have saved my life for you.
You have indeed, my dear girl, you have indeed. Oh, but I must see her. I must see my beloved Cora.
Doctor, take the advice of a simple, artless girl. Do not attempt to see her today. There are seasons of emotion when a woman go downstairs and write to her and then deliver the letter to me.
I will, by Jove. Miss Feversham, you're a good sort. And as you've told me something, I'll tell you something. Adrian is going to storm the castle today.
Adrian!
Since you commanded, I enter.
Let me pass, bold youth!
Why this avalanche? Has something happened suddenly?
Several things have happened suddenly, Adrian, and several more things will happen when your mama discovers that you are defying her orders in this most audacious manner. Why are you here? You perfect duck!
I am not here. Miss Feversham.
Miss Feversham? And my kiss still warm on his lips.
I repeat, Miss Feversham, that I am not here. This is not I, but merely a rather smart member of the staff of the Daily Snail, come to interview Cora Prout, the celebrated novelist.
And I have kissed a snail reporter. Ouch!
Impetuosity has ruined many women.
It is a morning of calamities. Your card, please.
With pleasure.
Never see interviewers this early.
Then I shall call this afternoon.
You must write for an appointment.
Oh, I'll take my chances.
We never give them. It is our rule. We have to be very particular. The fact of the matter is, we hate being interviewed. Any suggestion of notoriety, any sense of self-advertisement is completely distasteful to us. What is it you wish to interview us about? If it's that new novel, we are absolutely mum about that. Accept that from me.
It is not about the new novel. The snail wishes to know whether Mrs. Prout feels inclined to make any statement in response to that article, Medicine and Fiction, in the Forum.
Adrian, do you know anything about that article?
I rather do. I know all about it.
You
you treasure, you invaluable darling. I will marry you tomorrow by special license.
Recollect, it is a snail reporter whom you're addressing. Suppose I were to print that.
Just so, you are prudence itself. Well, I, on the other hand, am a little abnormal. I saved a man's life this morning, and it is very apt to upset one's nerves. It is a dreadful thing to do to save a man's life, and the consequences will be horrific for me.
Christine, what are you raving about? You're not yourself.
I wish I wasn't. Adrian, there's the possibility of your being able to save me from the results of my horrific act if only you will tell me the author of that article.
Oh, Christine. You little know what you ask. But for you, I will do anything. Kiss me, my white lily.
Christine, that horrible mother. Mrs. Prout, you seem to be better. So I'm going to interview you from the Daily Snail.
Adrian.
Yes? Mama?
Sit down!
Certainly, Mama.
How dare you come here?
I don't know, Mama.
Ha, that's just what I told the person, Mrs. Prout.
So you have then abandoned your medical studies, for which I had paid all the fees?
Yes. Mama, you see, I was obliged to earn something at once, so I took to journalism. I'm getting along quite nicely. The editor of The Snail says I may review your next book.
Natural stepson. To review in cold blood the novel of one's own stepmother. But this morning I'm getting used to calamities.
Oh, it cuts me to the heart to hear you refer to any action of mine as a misfortune to you. Perhaps you would prefer I at once relieve you of my presence.
Decidedly so. That is, if Christine can do without the fifth act of that caress I interrupted.
That curtain's already falling down.
Very good. Good day.
As a stepson, I retire. As a special of the Daily Snail, I must insist on remaining. A special of the Daily Snail is incapable of being snot. No, no, he knows what he wants, and he gets it, or he ceases to be a special of the Daily Snail.
I esteem the press. And though I should prefer a life of absolute privacy, I never refuse its demands.
Good.
I sacrifice myself for my public, knowing that a great artist has no exclusive rights over the details of their daily life. A great artist belongs to the world. So what is it you want, Mr. Snail?
I want to know whether you care to make any statement in response to that article, Medicine and Fiction, in the Forum.
Article again. Tell me, do you know the author?
I do.
His name?
He's a friend of mine.
His name?
I'm informed that in writing it, he was actuated by the highest of motives. His desire was not only to make a little bit of money, but to revenge himself against someone who had deeply injured him. He didn't know very much about medicine, being only a student, and probably the majority of his arguments could not be sustained, but he knew enough to make a show, and he made it.
His name?
I
insist.
Adrian Sprout. Oh, Prout. I have a poor memory.
Is it possible? Monster.
Need I defend myself, Mama? Consider what you had done to me. You had devastated my young heart, which was just unfolding to its first true passion. You blighted the springtime of the exquisite creature. The exquisite creature, Al, who was dearer to me than all the world. Instead of the luxury of my late father's home, you offered me the street.
Yes, and Gower Street.
You, who should have gently nurtured the frail buds of my energy and intelligence, you cast me forth.
Cast them forth.
Cast them forth to be untimely plucked to wither and perhaps die in the desert of a great city. And for what? For what?
Merely lest she be deprived of my poor presence. Mrs. Prout, can you wonder that Mr. Adrian should actively resent such conduct, you with your marvelous knowledge of human nature?
Adrian, did you really write it?
Of course. You seem more pleased than otherwise, Mama.
You didn't write, really. You're just boasting. It's a plot. A plot.
I can prove I wrote it, since you impugn my veracity.
How can you prove it?
By producing the check that was given to me this very morning by the editor of the Forum.
Produce the check, and I'll forgive all.
I fly. It's in my humble attic around the corner. I'll be back in 2 minutes.
Christine, did he really write it?
Can you doubt his word? Was it for lying that you ejected the poor youth out of this house?
But if he did, Dr. Gardner hasn't called.
Yes, he was in about 20 minutes ago.
Did you give him the note?
No.
Thank heavens.
I had not copied it out, so I read it to him.
You read it to him?
Yes, that seemed the obvious thing to do.
Oh, all is over.
Again.
I was looking out the window of my flat, and I saw Adrian tearing along the street. And I said to myself, a man, even a reporter, only runs like that when a doctor is required, and urgently required. Someone is ill. Perhaps my darling Cora. So I flew upstairs.
Dr. Gardner,
You are indeed ill, my beloved. What is it?
Nothing. Do you have any salts? I seem to have mislaid mine.
Salts? In an instant.
Christine, you said you read him my note.
Yes, Mrs. Prout.
His behavior is singularly in the extreme. He seems positively overjoyed. And the endearing freedom of his sentiments. I mean, what was it I put in the note? Read it to me again.
Yes, Mrs. Prout. The answer to the question is yes, with a capital N.
With a capital N?
I mean, with a capital Y.
You're sure you're not ill?
Quite sure, Doctor. Quite sure. Christine, would you hand me that dictionary, please? Oh, see, I could not be mistaken. Christine, you have rendered me a service. A service for which I will not fail to express my gratitude. But I am compelled to dismiss you immediately from that service.
Dismiss me, madame.
Cora, can you be so cruel?
Alas, yes. She has sinned the secretarial sin. She has misspelt.
Impossible.
It is too true.
Well, tell me the sad details.
She is accused of spelling a no with a Y.
Dear me. And a word of one syllable, too.
Miss Feversham, I should not have thought it of you.
I have the proof right here in my hands. Right here. Here again, Doctor.
Yes. And to stay.
Adrian, the doctor and I are to be married. And speaking of marriage, you'll notice that creature there in the corner. Take her and marry her at your earliest convenience. She's no longer my secretary.
You consent.
I consent.
And you pardon my article?
No, darling Adrian, I ignore it. As for your ill-gotten gains, take them. They'll come to no good. And since they'll come to no good, I shall give you £500 a year. I mean, you must have something.
Oh, stepmother!
Cora, you're an angel.
Merely an artist, Tom. I have a dramatic sense, is all.
Oh, your sense is more than dramatic. It's common. It's even hoarse. What of the snail special, mummy?
My attitude is one of strict silence.
But I must come away with something.
Strict silence, the attack is beneath
But what can I say?
Say that Mrs. Prout's late secretary, Miss Feversham, having retired from her post, has already entered into a career of original literary composition. Oh. That'll make a nice little newsy item, won't it?
Rather. What is she at work on?
Well, I don't...
Oh, I know. Hysteria in Lady Novelist.
What?
Didn't you tell me so?
No. Doctor, what a shocking memory you have. It is worse than my spelling.
Well, then, what did you say?
Generosity in Lady Novelist.
Mm-hmm. the grammar of
silly born idiots! What is this word coming to? I beg your pardon. I thought I was quite alone.
Oh, you were referring to the dancing.
Yes, of course, upon my word. Preposterous, isn't it?
Oh, you mean so unconventional.
Unconventional? That's hardly the word for it. That's hardly the word for it.
Yes. These coming out parties are not what they were when we were young. Oh, yes.
Coming out parties? Why? It seems like hardly anybody's in these days.
Oh, well, won't you sit down, Colonel?
General, madam, general.
Oh, general, I do beg your pardon. We were speaking of the dancing. Oh, you know, the world moves so fast nowadays, I suppose the dancers must keep up with the world.
The world running away with itself.
Yes. Well, things are certainly different from when we were young, but we must be tolerant. We are the old people now.
Old, madam? Not old. Middle aged, perhaps, but not old.
Yes, that's right. Middle aged.
There goes that unspeakable music again. Why, it sounds like the tom-toms one hears in Africa. Oh, much worse, even. But you are correct. Times do change, but it seems like things are going backwards rather than forwards. But we must accept the facts.
Unfortunately.
I had hoped that when I came here tonight, when I accepted this invitation to this ball, that I would see some reminder of my youth, however remote.
Ooh.
But it seems that they've even redid the house.
Then you've been here before. May I ask when you were here?
Yes. It was 42 years ago.
Oh, it was some time ago. But you know, I know this house very well. Nothing has been changed. Nothing.
Nothing?
No.
Really?
No.
Well, it seems to me like it's been changed. Are you sure?
Well, you know, when one gets older, one's
madam.
That is to say, when one is middle-aged,
Middle-aged? I'm just in the prime of my life. The very prime. Why, I don't feel a day past 20. Not a day past 20. Why, in the Indian service, they still call me Richard.
Richard?
Yes, and in the East Indian United Service, sometimes they call me Dick. Oh, not to my face, mind you, but they do call me Dick.
Richard, East Indian United Service Club. May I ask?
Yes, that's it. Yes, I'm not really old. Of course, I have accomplished a great deal since I was in His Majesty's service. Why, it was 41 years tomorrow that I set out. Yes, for a young man, I have accomplished a great deal in the service.
41 years ago. 41 years ago?
Yes. Is it so long ago as that?
Oh, is it so long ago?
I dare say that you and I might have known each other back then.
Perhaps.
I don't believe I asked you your name. Awfully stupid of me, awfully.
Colonel, perhaps you could tell me more about your past here. When you used to come here, you perhaps met someone?
Oh, yes, you know, quite right. As I was saying, when I came here, I thought I might see some remnant of the past. Oh, in the nooks and crannies and that sort of thing. Some familiar faces, one familiar face, in fact.
Then you...
Oh, of course. Like all young men, until I got some sense, I was badly in love with her, foolishly so. Couldn't live without her and that kind of thing. Why, she was very clever, pretty, very pretty, if I remember. She had blue eyes and blonde hair, that sort of girl.
But then you went away and forgot her.
Yes, quite right. The military, or the service, rather, is quite strenuous. And, of course, there was always polo and hunting and that sort of thing.
And you married someone else?
Never! Oh, I beg your pardon, madam. I beg your pardon.
And the young lady? What became of the young lady?
I dare say that she's the mother of a large family. My, how things do change. Oh, I was very much in love with her at the time. At the time, mind you. But the family, that is, her family, objected to me. So I called off the whole affair, joined the service, and I have been quite content, quite content.
Yes, yes. And have you made any attempt to see the young lady since your return to England?
See her? See her? Oh, that could be quite embarrassing for both of us. You see, I almost asked her to marry me. Well, I didn't come right out and say it in so many words, but you know how some things are just kind of understood.
And did you think it over carefully, very carefully?
Not at all. Why, I was such a character back in those days. My pride was hurt. I was a proud fellow, like so many young men. I thought she'd come waltzing in and spend the rest of her life with me in my arms. That is, in marriage.
Yes, as your wife, I understand.
As my wife. Oh, yes, yes, as my wife.
You were a romantic youth.
Oh, exceedingly so. I believe I was reading from the novels of Disraeli at the time. Rubbish.
And you quite lost all trace of the young lady.
Oh, quite, quite. I was a conceited ass who wouldn't have thought of writing to her for all the world. But I do remember reading in the Times that Anne and her...
Anne?
Yes, Anne. Anne. Very pretty name, isn't it? I've always liked that name. Anyway, it said in the Times that she went away to Florence with her father. After that, nothing.
And so your romance ended?
Yes. No, you've never... Yeah, that's right. Quite right. It ended.
And you never married?
No, I was much too busy. Oh, I did think of it from time to time. Not often, mind you, but I did think of it. But it did get kind of lonely sometimes, especially when hunting season was off.
Oh.
But I must tell you, a man should get married. I needed someone to accompany me and...
You've outgrown the need?
Oh, quite, quite. My man is quite capable, quite. There goes that infernal music again.
Oh, it's a waltz. Oh, yes, a waltz. Oh, music brings back so many memories. And the young people are so happy. 42 years ago, I too could dance and laugh as they, but now I...
40? You? Really?
Yes. 42 years ago, in this very house.
42 years ago? Was it that long?
Is it so long ago?
Perhaps. Now, we might have known each other at that time.
Oh, perhaps we did, and then again, perhaps we didn't.
I don't believe I got your name. Awfully stupid of me, awfully.
Well, perhaps we knew each other, and then again,
Quite right, quite right. I suppose you went away to England then and spent your time there?
No. That is to say, I've spent a great many years away from England. I own a small villa in Florence.
Really? Delightful place, Florence.
Yes, though a bit lonely at times.
Oh, I always thought Florence was quite gay. It just goes to show how wrong a man can be.
Yes, yes.
And, of course, you are very busy with your children and...
No, I never married.
Never married?
No.
Well, that's unusual, isn't it?
Is it?
And I suppose you never will.
No.
You know, there's that music again.
General, perhaps we should join the others.
General Sir Richard Barrington.
Oh, do pardon my mistake.
You know, I would like to know who the person is who I had this wonderful half hour of conversation with. To whom or whom may I thank for this?
I am Lady Anne Travers.
Lady Anne Travers? Not Lady Anne of...
Yes, Sir Richard.
Oh, my Lord. Bless my soul, Anne Travers. I should have known you from the start, but I don't see quite as well as I once did. Anne Travers, and to think of all these years in this very house.
Yes, Richard.
And you never married?
Never married, no.
Upon my word, what I thought.
You were mistaken. It was you I loved then.
Anne, when you said we must think these things over very carefully, you meant...
Yes, I really meant...
Isn't that just like a woman? Isn't that just like a woman?
Yes.
Oh, what happy days those were.
Happy days.
That's a waltz, isn't it?
Yes, it's a waltz.
And will you have the rest of this waltz with me?
Yes, Richard.
Or he smokes in the parlor. Or he repents his rashness in recanting bachelorhood. And she reflects, as his faults become plain to her, she might have done better. And they do not increase and multiply and are unhappy. And so come to furnish material for another play. But of the time between, of the time immediately after she has said yes and before she has begun to say no. Woo!